Simon & Schuster Audio presents The World Deserves My Children by Natasha Leggero, read by the author, including a conversation with Moshe Kasher.
To my mother, my children, and my children's children. Introduction. I love throwing parties. There isn't an event that I don't think of as an excuse for a party. That might be the one thing I like most about Judaism, i.e. the religion my husband forced me to convert to. Jews have a party where we drink wine, eat bread, and your husband blesses you every Friday night. I've always wanted to be blessed weekly. I've thrown every kind of party, from a dog's baptism to my own yard wedding. So naturally, on the eve of the first woman being elected president, my husband and I agreed we had to throw an epic election coronation party. Inspired by a trend in Paris of turning public pools into floating movie houses, I rented a huge TV, wheeled it out by my pool, shoveled a bunch of greenhouse gas into the furnace, turned the water up to 101, got tons of giant pink inflatable swans that I begged my brother to blow up for me, and had the party catered with my favorite Mexican food. Get it? Mexican food? Trump? Ha ha. Like every other liberal idiot I share a bubble with, I knew Hillary was going to win. The day What's-His-Name was caught on tape saying that he grabs women by the pussy, I actually got annoyed that Hillary's campaign was still emailing me asking me for money. Enough, bitch. I think you got this. The sound was off on the TV as a bunch of comedians floated in the pool-sized hot tub. I'd made an awesome playlist with inspirational classics like The Times They Are a Changin' and We Are the Champions. As we lay on the inflatable pool toys, smugly basking in certain victory with our margaritas and mini burritos, the mood started to shift from ironic whimsy to intense dread. With Lou Reed's Perfect Day blaring from the speakers, we noticed Trump had won another state. There was less splashing from the pool. Adorable little burritos started to turn cold. An inner tube shaped like a flamingo frowned. I decided to get out of the tub, turn down the music, and start asking my smartest, most politically savvy friends what the hell was happening. I was hoping for a, "Don't worry, it's about to turn around." What I got was an, "If Trump wins Michigan, there's no way he won't win the election." I looked up at the giant screen looming over the chimichanga bar. He won Michigan. The splashing stopped. The margarita machine froze in terror. The flamingo looked like he was going to be sick. A chill swept over the party. There was silence, which is rarer in a group of comedians than a happy childhood. We were all in shock. Our bubble had been popped. Bewildered and soaking wet, people started getting out of the pool looking for towels. As I waved goodbye to my guests with an air of, "Yes, this was a bummer, but we'll all figure it out tomorrow." As I said, I'm a good host. I started picking up unused party horns and poppers that were lying on the tables and thought, maybe I won't have a kid. I froze my eggs on a whim when I was 38 and I didn't really think I would use them. I mean, I didn't even have a boyfriend at the time. I wasn't exactly maternal. I truly believed my classic joke. Having a baby is like a DUI from the universe. But still, I had some extra money and I thought maybe one day I might want a kid. In the same way I thought I might eventually want an infinity hot tub. I have one of those on ice, too. I could definitely live without one, but I thought it might be cute to have a little sidekick to take to the spa and play piano with, and who would join me in my Pinot and painting classes on Wednesdays. Together, we would reenact scenes from Impressionist masters, mother and daughter, rowing in a boat, brushing each other's hair, her lovingly emptying my bedpan and topping off my Chateau Margaux whenever I got parched. Every time I thought about it, though, having a kid just seemed like a lot of work. Not to mention it's expensive, majorly cuts into your leisure time, derails your career accomplishments, and destroys your romance with your partner. And despite all these sacrifices, it could still grow up and do makeup tutorials on TikTok. I also worried that in my future kid's lifetime, it would most likely experience coastal change, increased wildfires, plagues, pandemics, lack of resources due to overpopulation, nuclear war, and, maybe worst of all, more reality show presidents. How could I bring a child into a world where it would almost certainly one day hear a candidate for president say, "America, will you accept this rose?" Was it conscionable to have a child when it will just create more pollution in an already pretty full earth that, oh yeah, just happens to be on fire? I decided that it was. Why should I feel guilty for procreating? Even in the most tragic of times, people were having kids. World War II was the worst catastrophe in modern history, but 2 weeks after it ended, people were fucking so much that they gave birth to an entire generation of people who are now ruining the world. Okay, boomer? The truth is, no matter how bad the world is, people will still be getting married, they'll still be having kids, those kids will still be annoying, and there will always be husbands who are completely unhelpful and grandparents who are too frail to watch your kids. You may have to swab your nanny's larynx for viral shedding before she comes to work, but the cycle of life will not stop. When I decided to thaw my eggs and crack them over the cast iron griddle of my uterus, I had a husband, a house, and a career, and I knew just from gut feeling which parties to attend and which to skip. How unfair would it be if I kept those little frozen potential Leggeros from attending the party that is my life? I decided to become a mom when I was in my prime, but when the world most certainly was not. That's what this book is about. Waiting just long enough to have a child so that you're stable and ready for whatever parenthood throws at you, but not so long that you have to give birth in an underground city where oxygen is piped in from the surface and your children think piles of dirt or trees. And if you do wait too long, don't stress. You're literally creating a bunker mate to hang out with you and eat rehydrated beans with. I mean, who wants to do that alone? If you're on the fence about the state of the world or your own readiness to raise a child and give up your freedom, do what I did. Face the most monumental decision you'll ever make and say, "Hey, fuck it. Why not?" In fact, "Why not" is the name of my sweet, sweet daughter. That's a lie. So, what's it like being a mother? Women are troublesome cattle to deal with mostly. Samuel Lover, Handy Andy, 1842. Woman is not intended for great mental or for great physical labor. She expiates the guilt of life not through activity, but through suffering, through the pains of childbirth, caring for the child, and subjection to the man, to whom she should be a patient and cheering companion. Arthur Schopenhauer, On Women, 1851. I've been trying to finish reading a magazine article for 7 months, and it's not even from one of the smart magazines people in New York pretend to read on the subway. I've bought 6 books on my Kindle and have read 0% of all of them. Sorry, Michelle Obama. I've downloaded all 500 hours of TV that Ryan Murphy has made in the last 6 months, but I haven't watched any of it because I go to bed at 9:30, and I love highly stylized sass. So, what's it like being a mother? My single, childless, 38-year-old male friend asked over coffee. I'd spent the previous 20 minutes droning on about the minutiae of child-rearing, but I guess he hadn't been listening.
Can you, like, read a book while you watch your baby?
No, not unless you want her to fall off a cliff. I prefer to read on the bluffs above Malibu. You can't do shit. Your time no longer belongs to you. I tried to explain to him that having a kid is loving something so intensely that you can't live without it, mixed with desperately wanting that something to take a nap so dangerously long that you have to go into its room and check if it's still breathing.
Sounds like being a mom is hard, he said,
in the type of understatement only available to child-free men of a certain age. But then he went a step further.
Sounds like it really takes over your whole life.
That thought panicked me. I don't want my whole life to be taken over. I didn't have a kid to get a new life. I had a kid to enrich the one I already had. I'm not just a mom. I mean, I've been a human adult for far longer than I've been a mother. What happened to that person? Before my daughter was born, I spent 3 years decorating my house exactly how I wanted it. I'd spent a lot of years figuring out what I liked and then a lot more years working hard to be able to afford it. You have to tell a lot of jokes to pay for Hermes grass cloth wallpaper. I found the perfect fabrics, the perfect furniture, the perfect fixtures. I talked my husband out of every bad decorating idea he had, including building a trash chute that emptied out of the dining room window.
It's like a slide, but for garbage.
And I'd won every battle. I didn't need the thousands of Instagram likes to tell me that my house was perfect. Tens of thousands, if we're being specific. I had the jealous looks of all my friends in real life to do that. And then, before I could even dent the cushions in my vintage velvet armchairs, I was being...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.